chosen Hard Day's Night by the Beatles, directed by Richard Lester. I remember going to the pictures and having the most wonderful time. And it was first shown, I think, in 1964, 1965, and I saw it in the Bromley Odeon. And in those days, obviously, you went to the pictures with your mum. And the place was just full of people screaming. And the mothers were screaming as well, which was even more thrilling to see your parents behaving in such an uninhibited way before you went home for your baked beans on toast. And I remember thinking, I want to be like that. That the world in which they inhabited was so exciting and was so liberating. It was a world of young kids who were like John Lennon and Paul McCartney, who were not working in banks, and they were running around, and they were wearing these fantastic suits and had great haircuts. And they were completely free, and they had money, and they had girls, and they were living exciting lives. And you just thought, I want that. Because the Beatles aren't really actors, they shot it as a documentary, and there's sort of French New Wave feel to it as well. It's the way the camera moves, the lightness of the camera. And also there's a sort of, it's the first pop video, the fast cutting, the lack of narrative, just the images cut together with music and so on. And there's a wonderful scene with their manager or the PA or whoever is trying to get them on stage. You can see them arguing among themselves, bickering, Lennon being belligerent and obstreperous. Then the guy in the mohair jumper being mocked because he's older than 30.
Some people have it dead easy.
Now, once you're over 30, you're past it. It's a young man's medium. I just can't stand the pace.
Oh, you're as young as that then?
I was.
And then suddenly they play this fantastic song, and they play it really well.
Music!
But what's interesting also is the way they show the monitors. I mean, you'd never seen a film being made from behind in that way, and I think in those days it was quite brave to actually see the process of making a film and how you cut between the faces and so on. I think what was so exciting about the Beatles at that time was the sense that they were respectable as well as a horrible pop group with long hair. And it was the first time I was aware of culture being something that you could be connected to yourself. Culture was for posh people. Culture was what happened at school. It was outside you, you know, and the writers that I thought about, I don't know, William Golding or Iris Murdoch or Graham Greene, they were not people who you could think of being like. But the Beatles were like you, and they were making culture. They were making records which were really good.
The kiss my lover brings, she brings to me.
When I started to write, it made me think that the subjects with which you wrote about could come from your own life. There weren't certain subjects that, as a writer, you had to deal with, that you could write about kids who went to parties, who had certain haircuts, who liked music, who, you know, who were involved in the world of pop. And suddenly I saw that this could be a subject for writing, as it had been a subject for films.
I now declare this bridge open.
I remember we had a teacher at school who insisted that the Beatles didn't write their songs. And he said that all the songs were written by Brian Epstein, because he couldn't believe that John Lennon and Paul McCartney could write such clever songs and be 20 and be rude and be horrible schoolboys and be geniuses at the same time. It was too much for him. And I remember thinking, I can't understand why you can't believe that they wrote that song. And when you see them play it and you see how good they are, it all sort of becomes clear.
Bright are the stars that shine, dark is the sky.